Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me today for an episode of EBTV, where I have the pleasure of featuring special guest Dr. Larry Malerba. Hi, doctor, and welcome.
Hi, Vita. It's great to be with you again today.
It is wonderful indeed to have you back, as we've had the pleasure of connecting a few years back when it came to discussing the topics related to your first book, Green Medicine, and what that really means from a holistic perspective in terms of our health, wellness, and how our healthcare is structured in our society today. And so before we get started, I will just share with our audience a little bit more about you. Dr. Larry Malerba is a physician, educator, and writer whose mission is to build bridges between holistic healing, conventional medicine, and spirituality. He is the author of two books, the first one being Green Medicine, Challenging the Assumptions of Conventional Healthcare, and his new book, Metaphysics and Medicine, Restoring Freedom of Thought to the Art and Science of Healing, as well as the writer of countless articles on his own sites, as well as various popular media. And so for anyone who's, again, missed the first video, there is a link provided here that can guide people to watch and experience all of the wonderful information that you shared about really the nature of health and disease and the mind-body connection and so many other vital topics that we went into in our first talk. Now today, before we get started and really dive into the wonderful information that you put together in Metaphysics and Medicine, can you just give people a little bit, just a very short summary of how you got to do and be where you are today with respect to your professional background?
Well, I originally went to medical school with the intention of studying psychiatry. And right away, as soon as I got there, I bumped into a doctor who was teaching family practice medicine at the school, but was teaching homeopathic medicine during lunch breaks as an unofficial course to anyone who wished to come. So I was curious, and I went in and wound up following him and spent the entire duration of my medical school training, whenever I had free moments, spending time with him and learning homeopathy side by side with conventional medicine. And I had this sort of unique opportunity to practice in his family practice clinic, where he would provide the kind of care that each patient requested. So they'd come in the door and he'd say, well, do you want conventional treatment or you want homeopathic treatment? And so I got to see the two side by side and got to compare the results. Then he, you know, gradually gave me more and more responsibility and allowed me to see patients on my own with his supervision. And that's how I got started. And that's what led me to what I do today.
So having now over 25 years of experience, I believe it is, in terms of helping and healing people and also teaching, you part of the academic institutions as well as writing, what is your view of the conventional Western medicine model that is being practiced and applied today?
That's a big question, and that's the subject of my books, right? So to me, the purpose in writing both books was to help educate the public about the differences in perspective between sort of the conventional medical worldview and the holistic worldview. And the new book, Metaphysics of Medicine, is more about the sort of unconscious philosophical beliefs that are behind the practice of conventional medicine. Conventional medicine claims to be pure science, when in fact there are a lot of basic assumptions that are never discussed that affect the way they look at science. And there is not one single way of looking at science, even though they might give that impression, or one way to practice medical science, right? There are a number of different ways. And so my books and my mission is to try and educate the public about the difference between science as the original ideal as it was conceived, science as the conventional medical model of science. When the authority of science is abused, it becomes scientism, and then comparing all that to authentic science, which to me is closer to what holistic medical practices are about, practicing a more authentic form of science.
So to give people a little bit more of a background of how vital this is in terms of the work that you are doing. I'm going to share that in 2004, there was a report put out called Death by Medicine. I came across that a few years ago that presents compelling evidence that today's system frequently causes more harm than good. And it gives, you know, just incredible statistics, which I'm sure you're already aware of as well, in terms of how many adverse reactions, like 2.2 million per year, are due to drug interactions or side effects. The number of unnecessary antibiotics prescribed annually, something like 20 million per year. The number of unnecessary medical and surgical procedures performed, again, about 7.5 million per year. So we're talking here about big numbers and, of course, the unnecessary hospitalizations and the number of deaths, in fact, bringing the total number of deaths caused by conventional medicine to be the leading cause of death and injury in the U.S. And that was, of course, as of 2004. But I don't think much has changed, in if not probably gotten worse in many aspects. So this is why, again, you know, people like yourself who are writing on these topics and speaking and teaching and, you know, trying to help people understand, I think is so very, very important to give us a broader understanding of what is happening and how we can have a better understanding and exercise the choices that we may not even realize we have. So as you mentioned, you know, in your books, both books, of course, you present so many of these facts, but in Metaphysics and Medicine, you know, when people first hear this title, I know when I first heard the title, I thought Metaphysics and Medicine, wow, this is, you know, going to dive into certain spiritual topics. But the book is incredibly elegant compilation of extremely academic, well thought out, intelligent and wise views and research in terms of where were we, where are we, and where are we headed if we continue down this path. So can you give us a little bit more of an understanding of how does metaphysics actually influence medicine?
Right, that's a very good question. And that's the point of the book, is to say that our worldview affects the way we look at medicine. The worldview of conventional medical practitioners affects the way they practice medicine. The worldview perspective of medical educators affects the way they look at health and healing and illness and disease, right? If you start with the assumption, for example, that like the medical worldview, the conventional medical worldview holds, that all that exists, or at least all that is important, is the material world, then you're going to have a very different concept of medicine than, say, some holistic practitioners who say that, well, there's a very real non-physical world, the world of consciousness, the world of thought, the world of spirituality, and so on, right? And as we know, the conventional medical model does not take the non-physical aspect of human experience seriously and has no place to fit it into their system of health and healing. When it hears information like that from patients, at best, all a regular doctor can do is nod his head and be respectful and say, well, that's interesting, and then simply move on to the pertinent facts, so to speak, of their version of material medicine, right? So that's just one little example of a philosophical bias that underpins the practice of conventional medicine, materialism, right? Materialism is all that counts. And as long as we get your physical body fixed up, you're going to be okay, even though the patient may be complaining, I don't feel well, you know, my mind isn't right, my thoughts aren't right, my emotional state is not right. Or, you know, just take it from another angle by an example of, let's say that a child is experiencing a great deal of stress in the home environment, and the parents are arguing and fighting a lot, and the child develops headaches and goes to school and winds up going to the nurse's office repeatedly saying, I have headaches, right? So we go to the doctor, and the doctor says, okay, well, he's got headaches. Let's give him a pill for his headaches, and thereby doing nothing about the real source of the problem, which is the marital discord and the dysfunctional environment at home and how that's affecting the poor little guy's psyche, which then is generating headaches. So the headache is just kind of the tip of the iceberg. Mm-hmm. It's the material result of the deeper psychic issue, and all medicine can do is address the material result. It can't get to the bottom of things because it doesn't have a medical perspective or a medical philosophy that incorporates those deeper aspects.
And something that you mentioned in the book is the consequences, really, I think, that are so profound of the fact that medicine fails to incorporate our new quantum worldview. Can you talk a little bit about these consequences?
Material science has made wonderful discoveries and all kinds of technological innovations, but that does nothing for the practice of medicine other than to perhaps give us more effective techniques to replace that hip joint, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the surgical procedure itself and the technical details of how to replace the hip joint are advancing, right? But when it comes to healing people, that's a whole nother thing that is a whole nother quantum level beyond just the material world. So the quantum worldview is where largely most of alternative medicine is operating from. It's more of a holistic worldview
mm-hmm.
that sees the role of consciousness in the development of illness and understands that you can't just attend to the physical and neglect the deeper aspects of the psyche and the spirit and the soul and so on. There are other sort of conventional medical beliefs besides materialism. You have reductionism, right? Reductionism says that we're going to break the body down into its component parts and we're going to look for answers in the individual tiny little parts. So if we can just manipulate that body part or that chemical pathway, we're going to find a solution to disease. Whereas holism is on the opposite end of the spectrum and says you can't intervene at that chemical level without generating unforeseen consequences to the greater whole. So you need to always be looking at the impact upon the whole, which medicine almost never does. It by definition, its version of science forces it to focus in on tiny details. That's what its science does. That's what reductionism is, right? And so that's another one of those conventional medical metaphysical beliefs that creates conventional medicine. We have materialism and reductionism, and you have mechanism and objectivism and so on and so forth. There's a lot of different faulty concepts that medicine still adheres to that to holistic practitioners seem very out of date and render medicine incapable of dealing with the whole person.
Yeah, absolutely. And so you've mentioned some of the isms, and really the isms are such a big part of your book, and they play such an integral role as you really go into detail of each one and some of the ones you've already mentioned, like understanding the difference between science and scientism, or the idea of materialism. So let's look at a few more of these in terms of what implications they have for us, as again, both on the patient side and also for anybody who's joining us in the audience who may also be a medical or healthcare practitioner or provider. So with respect to reductionism, I'd love to come back to this a little bit more, because one thing that you brought out and really stood out for me is that it brings about the illusion of control and leaves us with a very fragmented worldview. Can you talk a little bit more about this?
Sure. I mean, I think that's the motivation. One of the motivations behind reductionism is that it narrows the scope of what the scientist or the doctor has to deal with, right?
Yeah.
That's what results in our fragmented medical world, where you have all these different specialties, none of which have any interest in communicating with each other. They each have their own little scope of practice, their own turf, their own territory. And so the body is broken up into its different parts according to different doctors. And, you know, reductionism forces them to just look at one little aspect and makes it impossible to understand the interconnections. Of course, the biggest interconnection that reductionism avoids is the mind-body connection, right? Even the concept of mind and body is a reduction, right? We separate a human being into mm-hmm. a mind and a body as if they are two separate things, which is kind of silly, right? If you think about it, you know, you and I don't walk around saying, well, this is my mind and this is my body. It just is. We are one. It is one. And science wants to break it up into parts and study it in isolation as if you can do that. You can't do that without having a significant impact upon the results that you get and upon the solutions that you come up with for health problems, right? So reductionism needs to be balanced with holism. Yeah. Reductionism has its role, right? I mean, reductionism is important. So if I spring a leak in an artery and I run to the ER, they're going to be able to locate that artery and patch it up and keep me from dying or bleeding to death. And so that's an important skill to have, but that's far from the whole story of medicine, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And this brings us also to another ism, which is the mechanism, medical mechanism that you speak of in your book, where Western medicine confuses association with causation and thus gets itself into a circular way of thinking. Can you talk a little bit about this and its implications?
I mean, mechanism is part of the conventional medical philosophy that assumes that the only valid thoughts regarding the nature of health and illness are phenomena that we can identify as having a cause and effect relationship. If we cannot identify a cause and effect relationship, then we cannot study it. At least that's the bias of medicine, right? So right away, the first thought that any holistic person has is that, well, there's no way you can identify a mechanistic cause and effect connection, a physical material cause and effect connection between mind and body, right? Mm-hmm. So on the one hand, we have the material body. On the other hand, we have the immaterial mind. And so science, if it's trying to search for a connection between the two, it's not going to find it. Or it's going to fudge that and come up with a materialistic connection to fit their definition of science. So in other words, it'll say, well, the connection is the brain, the physical brain, and the chemicals that float around in the brain. And so that's the connection, right?
Yeah.
Except it still does not really give us what's the connection then, therefore, between the thought I just had or the emotion I had or the stress I'm feeling over my financial difficulty and that brain of mine and those chemicals in my brain. We still don't see any connection. So since it cannot identify a concrete material mechanistic connection between the two, it just dismisses the whole topic as if it doesn't exist, thereby eliminating the most important factor in human health and illness. You know, so that's mechanism is another one of those. It's a bias. It's an inappropriate way of looking at things. It can be helpful in certain individual situations, but it cannot be applied to the whole.
Yeah, and this is again what keeps bringing us back to that bigger picture perspective, that the medical field would benefit from so much in terms of adequately taking care of, you know, the health and healing that it's supposed to. Now, another ism that you explain so well is rationalism. And you state that it's one of the most flagrantly abused isms of Western medicine. And I really, really, you know, like that you pointed that out. Can you talk a little bit more about this and why you feel this way?
You know, it's interesting. I mean, I think that because of the nature of the culture that we live in, we don't question rationalism, and yet it's everywhere. It's ubiquitous. It permeates everything we think about and do and say. So in other words, it used to be that science was about observing the phenomena, doing experiments, and coming up with information resulting from those observations and experiments, right? But nowadays, science has taken a leap way beyond that to the point where whatever its logic states, it assumes to be true. So science is no longer science. It's just logic justified by the claim of science, by the word science. So we've gotten to the point where some guy in a white jacket can get on TV and say, well, according to science, and then he can say whatever he wants, as long as it sounds logical, right? Yeah. And everyone believes it, regardless of how much actual evidence there is behind that idea. So, for example, right, for the longest time and still, most people have heard the explanation, the logic, that depression is caused by a chemical imbalance. And by virtue of our materialistic orientation, which tends to believe materialistic explanations, right? Oh, it's the brain and it's brain chemicals. Those are things we can see and touch and see on x-rays and so on and so forth. And because of the fact that it sounds logical, right? Well, these chemicals float around in your brain, and if they're not the right chemicals, you wind up feeling depressed. Therefore, everyone believes it, regardless of whether that's true or not. So science is full of, medical science is full of, and science is full of all sorts of claims that sound logical, that are really not scientific. They're just rationalizations, right? They're coming to conclusions based on logic without evidence. And that's what a great deal of conventional medicine is all about. I see it the most when I'm talking to my own patients in the office. When they come in, they start to tell me the nature of their problem, and then they say, well, my other doctor says it's this, right? And then you hear these kind of explanations, or the logic that they give to it makes no sense. It's just, it sounds logical, but it's not true. Mm-hmm. And yet, by virtue of the logic, the patient believes it and nobody questions it. Another simple example is, like, it's kind of a general practice in medicine that if someone sprains an ankle or sprains a joint, by the logic of it, we are automatically told to apply cold in the initial phase and later on down the road apply heat, right? And so because the logic says that if you apply cold right now, you're going to reduce the inflammation and reduce the swelling, and that's going to help. And by logic, it says that later on down the road, if you apply heat, you're going to help loosen up the joint and help it feel better, and so on. And that sounds really great. Nobody would argue with that, right? It's so logically sound, even though it is experientially untrue. In other words, if you actually took a bunch of people who just sprained their ankles, you would have a certain percentage of them who, if you told them to apply heat and they proceeded to do so, they would start to complain that it feels worse and they don't want to do it. So the reality is it comes down to individual cases. Each person is different, and each person's way of reacting to a traumas are different. So medicine comes along and wants to impose its logic on the situation, and instead a holistic perspective would say, no, you need to see each individual person as they are. So if this person tells me that my joint's feeling better when I'm putting heat on it right after it happened, and now it's 3 months later and it still tends to hurt, so I apply ice to it and it feels better, right? It defies the conventional logic. So the rationalism, the logic of that makes no sense. I mean, makes sense, but the reality of the patient completely, you know, counteracts the logic of medicine, right? So, and that's the thing of it. Everybody is different. Each situation is unique, and you cannot apply formulas ahead of time that we accept simply because they sound logical.
Yeah, and you know, you stress throughout the entire book the dehuman, like we've lost that human aspect, that we basically dissected and separated everything out, but we do need to come back to the importance of what each individual is and how they are and their particular and specific challenges, etc. So, you know, this makes me think also of the phrase scientifically proven, which is just like, you know, as like you mentioned, you know, if somebody starts by saying, well, according to science, but so many people don't realize the extreme biases that are prevalent. And, you know, just these lines today or these two words, scientifically proven, make me almost cringe sometimes, especially when I see them used by the general public. But going back to that individual approach that you are mentioning and that would be so much more prevalent, of course, isn't good for business. And I think, you know, that's probably one of the main reasons why perhaps we're also not going down that path. Has this been also your experience?
Sure. I mean, it's a whole lot harder to practice medicine that is individualized to each patient. It requires more work, more thought. It requires more input from the patient. And it's a whole lot easier to just apply basic formulas to stereotyped concepts of what diseases are, right? So, you know, you can have someone with bronchitis, and in conventional medicine, everyone's going to get basically the same treatment. They're either going to say, depending upon the nature of the doctor, they're either going to say, well, you can probably do without an antibiotic. Just go home and get fluids and rest, or they're going to get an antibiotic. Whereas a holistic practitioner was going to look at each individual case. So one person may say that, you know, I was out in the cold weather yesterday, and it was 0 degrees and windy, and by the time I got in that night, I started coughing, and I have this terrible cough now. And someone else may say, well, my grandmother died a week ago, and yesterday I came down with this cough, right? Mm-hmm. And someone else may say, I had this big fight with my girlfriend, and I feel really upset, and then a few days later, I came down with this cough. And someone else may say, I had a skin rash, and I put some cortisone cream on it, and the rash disappeared overnight, which is the first time it went away in 6 months, and 2 days later I came down with this cough. And someone else may say, I came down with this cough, which only acts up at night, and I can't sleep. And as soon as I get up in the morning and I walk around, it's gone. And someone else may say, I cough all day long, and I can't stop coughing until I lay down at night, and the cough goes away. Right? And so when you see the reality of patients, you understand that it's not possible to apply simple formulaic approaches to a stereotype of what something is supposed to be. This is what bronchitis is supposed to be, you know, and it's not true. It's much more diverse and complicated and individualized than that, and that's you know, medicine doesn't want to do that because that's a lot of work and that's a lot of thought, and that's going to take away from our easy profits by just dispensing antibiotics.
Yeah, absolutely. So another point that you bring up is in the section on objectivism. This is where, you know, you've mentioned a few times the stereotypes, and of course we know that again today there's just so much bias within a field that, you know, doesn't want to question itself or have anyone else question it. And so the objectivism makes a lot of people feel that doctors or science or research is very objective. But this is really one of the illusions within the field. Can you talk a little about this?
Sure. You know, objectivity in the mind of the public and in the mind of science is almost the same thing as saying truth or fact, right? So when the word objective is used, we automatically go there in our minds. But if we examine what that really means, it means taking away all the personal factors that go into a human situation, right? So if we're being truly objective in that sense, the person whose bronchitis developed after the death of his grandmother, we're going to take that out because that's not objective information. Hmm. And the other person whose bronchitis developed after he had a fight with his girlfriend, well, we're going to ignore that too because that's not very objective. That's very subjective information, right? So objectivity says that we, in addition to the idea that there's a small legitimate role for objectivity in the sense of I'm going to try and be as unbiased as possible. That makes sense, right? But medical and scientific objectivism go much further than that. They go way over the bounds to the point where it says that subjective information is not reliable, not trustworthy, not valuable, not useful to us. So we're going to ignore all that stuff. In other words, we're going to ignore everything that the human mind thinks about, feels, and produces all of consciousness. And we're going to strictly focus on the objective facts, the so-called objective facts. And what are they? The material things again. We're back to materialism again, right? So it's philosophy. These biases in the conventional medical philosophy force it into a box that makes it unable to deal with the larger picture and the real issues that human beings face that lead to their health problems and that can be taken advantage of to solve their health problems, right? So there's another aspect of another meaning of objectivism that we talk about in terms of saying we want medicine tends to objectify illnesses. It turns them into objects as if they are separate things that exist outside of us that come and take over us, and if we can just get rid of them. So the language and the philosophy behind conventional science, conventional medicine, tends to lead to the objectification of ideas and concepts that are really ideas and concepts or that are intangible things that are now we're now making into physical objects, objectifying them, right? And so, you know, we can take anything, like even just the diagnosis of bronchitis, if we objectify it, it becomes inflammation of the bronchi caused by some germ that we haven't identified. And so that's the object that we call bronchitis, separating it all out from all the personal factors that each individual brings to their version of bronchitis.
Yes, and when you know, talk about more about this in the book, you mentioned too that, you know, we see it perhaps as the same disease, but at its root level, it actually could be a completely different manifestation of things in each individual, and that's what you're really getting at. And this is what I think is so important to make people aware of, that, you know, our views and healthcare approaches today have been made so sterile and so robotic, where again they've completely lost touch with our human nature, with our humanity, and this is what we need back so much, again, to thrive as a species at a time when we should be thriving, rather than, you know, lose so many people and decrease the quality of life due to the medical, you know, way of the stringent way of looking at things, the narrow and the biased way. But of course, when everybody across the board is educated in such a field the same way and therefore sort of believes the same way, it easily leads to conformism. And this is another aspect that you talk about, the medical conformity that is present. Can you talk about this? Because, you know, not just even for people as patients, but for perhaps inspiration for other healthcare providers like yourself to have more courage to be actually looking at the other side of the issue or the bigger picture, or have the courage to speak out as well.
Right. I mean, the pressure to conform in medicine and science is enormous. It's enormous. Yeah. The professional pressure that comes from colleagues, that comes from this giant scientific establishment, makes each individual feel like a small speck that I can't possibly have anything to say in the face of all of that scientific fact, right? And yet there's so much that each individual has to say. If you just simply bring to the table your experiences that you have with your patients and all of that information that often goes against what the establishment says. So conformism works also in many different ways in medicine. One really interesting way is that no one ever questions this idea that, you know, they talk about the idea that research studies, in order to be valid, need to be reproducible, right? And so we think it can't be scientific unless I do that experiment over and over and get the same results. And if the results are different, then it's not scientific information, it's not useful, right? Okay, so that sounds logical to most people, right? And it may apply to strictly the material world, and even then, not always. So if we try to boil a thing of water, we're going to find, if we do that experiment over and over, it's going to boil at the same temperature. You're going to get reproducible results, right? Okay, that makes sense. But now if we try to apply that to human beings and their health problems, then all of that goes out the window. You know, you cannot take one study which has 100 people in it who all have the so-called diagnosis of bronchitis, knowing what we already have been talking about, that even those individual cases are all going to be so different. Then we're going to study them all as a big group and come to some conclusion, right? Then we're going to take another 100 people with the diagnosis of bronchitis. And if the two studies don't come out with the same results, we're going to say, well, now that's not useful to us and it's not scientific, right? And so medicine tries to force everything mm-hmm. to conform to its strangely limited worldview. And the results are often, you know, mangled ideas of what illness is, of what treatment should be, of what health is, of what a cure is, and so on and so forth, because it's too busy trying to get everyone to conform to these rules that it has set up, even though most doctors and scientists aren't even aware of those rules or those biases. And that's my point in writing this book, that no one's aware of these biases.
Yes.
They just proceed as if they are practicing science, and so that has been settled.
Yeah.
It's done. We don't need to think about it anymore, right? And yet I'm saying, whoa, we need to stop and think about what this so-called science thing is that we're doing, because my idea of science is different from your idea of science, and there's something wrong here, and we need to stop and examine this and take a understand the philosophy behind it and the metaphysical worldview behind it, and see that those beliefs affect the way we think about science.
Absolutely. And, you know, this is that conformity then translates, of course, to every average citizen. And the reasoning, again, being that we all think, well, we should be doing, especially, I notice this with so many parents, especially parents of young kids, you know, that conformity to vaccinate, that conformity to take a fever away right away, that conformity to dot, 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 right? And so it's very, very pervasive in our culture all throughout. But as you kept mentioning, you know, that limited view takes out the fundamental aspects that we are now understanding, thanks to quantum sciences and such, like the role of the observer, which, you know, changes everything. And that's, again, takes us into that deeper nature of where we can take our healthcare and medicine if we were open enough to free thinking and to re-examining what we think we already know.
Mm-hmm.
So, Larry, this brings us down to, of course, there's a wonderful chapter also in the book that talks about skepticism, and as another ism, and the skeptics in our world. Obviously, some people who are going to be watching this, who are going to be perhaps reading your book, or just simply looking and exploring the nature of topics like this via any medium, via any teacher, expert, etc., will be open-minded enough to consider whatever it is, despite any personal biases. But some people won't be. And this is where you talk about the unfortunate nature of the group of in our society known as skeptics. Can you talk a little bit more about this and how this poses a challenge to us progressing further in positive and actually effective ways?
Sure. That's a really important topic. And, you know, skeptics claim to have the backing of science behind the things that they say and the beliefs that they hold, right? But we need to understand the difference. The public needs to be educated. The scientific community needs to be educated. The medical world needs to be educated about the differences between that ideal that we call science, right? Which originally was conceived as a way, a method of looking at the world around us and learning about the world around us, period, just like that, right? That's what science is really all about, okay? Yeah. Then we have the science that of conventional medical science, which is a science that involves all the various isms that we've been talking about. So conventional science has imposed these values, their values, their non-scientific values upon the practice of medical science. And those values are, right, materialism and reductionism and mechanism and rationalism and objectivism and so on, right? So conventional medical science is, it's fine if they do that. I have no problem with that as long as they acknowledge the reality of the limitations of what they're doing and don't step over their bounds. Yes. And don't say, therefore, we can use this method and treat mind-body problems, for example. Because you can't, because your philosophy doesn't even include mind in it. So you can't approach that problem at all with the philosophy that you hold, right? Okay, so we have the ideal of science, and then we have conventional medical science with its isms, which is okay as long as it's practiced within the bounds of what that scope is, right? And then we have scientism, right? Now, scientism or skepticism, you could use the two words interchangeably, is the abuse of science. Mm-hmm. So that it is used to justify just about anything whatsoever based on the very, very fact that I can simply say the word science. So if I say, you know, 4 out of 5 dentists say that this toothpaste is better than that toothpaste, suddenly it's science, right? And we all go, oh, wow, that's science, right? So skepticism is notorious for being anti-holistic medicine and anti-having anything to do with consciousness or consciousness studies, you know, it's like parapsychology and psychic phenomena, right? And anything having to do with the power of the mind, skeptics don't want anything to do with. They deny that there is any power. They want to reduce it to those isms, to the brain and brain chemicals and so on, and materialism and so on. So skeptics have a tendency to go about proclaiming that in the name of science, they know that anything holistic can't be true because it's not scientific, right? Or anything that this psychic person claims to be able to determine based on their psychic abilities can't be true because it's not scientific, right? So it's an absurd statement to say, you know, it can't be true because you're talking about consciousness and consciousness isn't real, therefore we're just going to dismiss it, right? So we're seeing scientism affect our culture now in a very powerful way, right? We're seeing it in the recent huge uproar about measles and vaccines, where you have all kinds of people who know nothing about anything going, well, science says that vaccines work, and therefore, everybody has to get vaccinated. So there's a lot in that loaded statement, right? And we can pick that apart in various ways. But the truth is that there's also a lot of science that says vaccines have side effects that can be very dangerous, right? But they don't want to talk about that part of the science. They want to stick to their made-up version of science that's in their head. And that's what we're seeing culturally. We see it in the media where they just parrot whatever they're fed by the medical establishment. The medical establishment takes advantage of it by feeding this information to them that is going to get everybody to conform again to get all those vaccinations, right? And there's a legitimate alternative perspective that nobody wants to talk about, that the media is unwilling to report on, right? Because if you really look at the history of measles, the truth, the actual fact, is that the original surge in measles many years ago, by the time that epidemic settled down was almost 99% gone, that's when the measles vaccine was introduced. And yet science claims that the vaccine has eliminated measles or has reduced it to almost nothing, when in fact the disease rose up in the population, settled down, and by the time they could actually formulate a vaccine to administer to people, the whole thing was almost a non-issue at that point. So there are all kinds of facts that scientism ignores in the name of its faith-based belief in science, which is just sort of an idea in their head that they apply to whatever they want to believe, right? So I can say anything is science just by saying it, and it sounds authoritative, right? And that's what scientism believers do, or skeptics do. They say something that sounds authoritative, and they use the word science, and everyone believes it.
Yes.
It's a proven fact that alternative medicine doesn't work. Just look at the science, you see? And then everyone goes, oh, yeah, there is no science behind that, so therefore alternative medicine can't be useful. And hence, this is what scientism is. It's uninformed people talking about scientific ideas that they have no idea what they're talking about.
Yeah. And you know, that convenient omission of facts is such a big and prevalent area, you know, in and of itself. So, yeah, thank you so very much for explaining that further, as indeed it touches upon this whole field and how we interact with our own health and wellness so much. And so, to mention to our audience, we will be doing a follow-up second part where we will focus on the practical applications of what all of these different isms are in terms of how they really impact our lives. One example you've just mentioned would be vaccines. We'll also talk about the supposed germ theory, about the antibiotics, about stress, about emotional precursors of disease, and so much more. But to finish this first part off, Larry, what do you say to people? Like, where do we go from here, really, at this point where we are now in 2015, both as citizens and perhaps for those, again, who are actual healthcare providers in the audience who are joining us?
Yeah, well, where we go from here is we it's just like any other societal or governmental institutions. We can't just automatically believe whatever we're told. We have to think for ourselves. And we've reached this point where we're so inundated with science as a culture that it's now a form of groupthink. Everybody just automatically believes what's said because people use the word science. But we need to think for ourselves, and we need to educate ourselves. And so we need to find other sources of information, of which there are many. Mm-hmm. You know, it's easy to go searching on the internet, looking in the bookstore, talking to other people about their experiences, and you'll find all kinds of alternative information about medicine, which is, you know, the topic we're talking about, so that you can really, you know, use your own judgment. It's one of the big problems that has been created by the scientific culture. It has convinced us.
Yeah.
That our own personal judgment is not valid, or our own experiences don't count for anything because science says this, and therefore you should shut up and be a good person and just follow what we say to you, right? We need to think for ourselves, and we need to trust what our own experience tells us. If I take a drug and I wind up with a side effect, and then I go to see the doctor, and the doctor looks in his book and says, well, that side effect's not listed for that drug, so it can't be a side effect of that drug. That's not what you're having, a side effect. That's a case where science is trying to overrule your own personal experience. That's when you have to say, no, I'm sorry, doctor. I know that this is being caused by the drug, and you need to pay attention and help me with this instead of just relying on the formula, right? And we've got to trust ourselves and our own instincts and our own experiences. Yeah. And that's what we have to do, educate ourselves and learn how to trust ourselves.
Excellent advice. Thank you so much for sharing that. And so for anyone who is interested in definitely delving deeper into this topic and having the courage to look at really what impacts our life and our society so much today when it comes to the entire field of science, medicine, and of course, health and healthcare, then I highly recommend your book, Metaphysics and Medicine, which is available now widely, especially the easiest place probably to get it is Amazon.com. Larry, can you mention to us any of your websites where you do writing, any other social media networks where people can connect with you?
Sure. My website, where I post a lot of my articles, is called spiritsciencehealing.com, just like that, spiritsciencehealing.com. My Facebook page is Doc Malerba, D-O-C Malerba, Doc Malerba at Facebook, and also Doc Malerba at Twitter. And by the way, Evita, I wanted to say congratulations on the new edition of your book. I think it's a fantastic book.
Thank you.
Anyone interested in nutrition really needs to read this because it's very solid and it's really great material. So congratulations.
Thank you so very, very much. Thank you.
And Evita didn't set me up to do that. I did that on my own.
Thank you so kindly. And so I look forward very much to our second part where we will again dive deeper into the practical applications. Thank you so much again for sharing all that you have and doing the work that you are doing, Larry.
Thanks. I look forward to the next time.
And thank you everyone for joining us, and until next time.